Today is a wonderful day in the life of Baylor. We are welcoming home today. Part of our mission is looking toward the great ability that you have to make a positive work. Waiting to start and begin that now, but it's an impressive lesson to all of us who teach at Baylor to see that there are those of us who leave from Baylor and do such outstanding things in the world. You know that we have begun talking a great deal about leadership and that we have a work in progress trying to figure out how best to enable you to be leaders. And we've talked to you about leadership comes to most of us in a reluctant way, that somebody gives you leadership and asks you to behave. You know that you have seen in the U.S. News and World Report on the October 31st edition, the nation getting very concerned again about leadership. Dr. Abshire comes to us today after having studied the presidency of the United States over some 40 years. He has looked at leadership both that failed and that worked among U.S. presidents. He convened a colloquium on leadership back in 1999, where he had such people as General Howard Graves, the retired superintendent from West Point, say that the leader is the one who's going to inspire our society, our community, our organizations to do what's right. We can be flexible, but we lead by example. Benjamin Latner, the president of American University, told him, leaders have this curious quality of being. I hope not the only, but sometimes the first to see farther, to see the only vision that others have not picked up on, to invest their lives in it. Dr. Abshire has invested his life in leadership. It's an honor to have this Baylor graduate back. He grew up here in Chattanooga, nourished by Baylor School, First Methodists, into a love of history from then, and it continues. You might know that he went to West Point, that he was a distinguished, decorated veteran in the Korean War, that he went back to teach at West Point, finished through with a doctorate at Georgetown. You know that he has studied, and as a matter of fact, as you think about recent U.S. history, he has touched and said hello and had a conversation. You go back and think about it. President Roosevelt, President Truman, President Nixon, President Ford, all the way through the last several presidents. This man has studied their actions, but he has talked to them. He knows them. Ever the historian, he has worked on Capitol Hill and congressional relations. He's done an outstanding job as United States Ambassador to NATO, back in what you studied as the Cold War, a critical time for our nation. You also know that he has worked with President Reagan and has a new book that is available for you, Saving the Reagan Presidency, where he has looked at presidential leadership in this country for years and years, compiling a list of case studies about what works and embarrassingly what did not work. But it's lessons for you. What we hope is that there is a president of the United States sitting right here today, and perhaps this lesson from our distinguished Baylor graduate will be important. Dr. Abshire, welcome home, sir.
Executive privilege has been lying, has been destroyed.
destruction of documents. You've got to restore integrity of the White House. This is a critical time during the Cold War, and after all, he was not just a commander-in-chief in America, but he was a leader of the NATO alliance, and Gorbachev was on the move. And there'll be an interim report, a tower board report. You'll be in the cabinet. You'll report to me directly. Every one of you in this room is going to get in a hole sooner or later if you live. You're going to make mistakes. That's natural. A person in a hole has got a choice to dig it deeper or to get out. Richard Nixon dug it deeper. He didn't know about the Watergate break-in. 5 days later, the President of the United States was leading the obstruction of justice. Bill Clinton did something of which he should have been deeply ashamed and was. And then he called somebody in and gotten out of the hole right away, the nation would have been disgusted for 2 weeks. We would have moved on to a great presidency. It seems so simple, doesn't it? The picture on the front of this book is President Reagan when I first came back. It was a terrible time. A columnist, Novak, had written that Reagan presidency is dead. And he has come out of the hospital with an operation so frail that Mrs. Reagan said, don't release that picture of him in Abshire. And she got a copy of his book because he said, that's the picture I didn't want released. And I said, you know, you don't want to cross her. I said, but look on the back. This is a month. This is 3 months later. We're laughing with the president. And the reason we're laughing is that as my little group came in to tell him goodbye and to say how much we appreciate and are indebted to you for service, he says, no, I'm indebted to you for finding me not guilty. That wasn't our job to find him not guilty. Our job was to get everything out and the evidence found him not guilty. Not of arms for hostages, and that wasn't against the law per se. But what Ollie North had done in the diversion of funds, which if he had known would have been an impeachable offense. That's character, to make terrible mistakes and to get in a hole and to get on higher ground. Now we have a crisis of character at all levels and parts of society throughout this country. I have a revered a chief executive officer, Lockheed Martin, former now, who served on the Procter & Gamble board with me. He's a person of no ego. He's a servant leader. He works with us on our leadership programs. And he started his new speech like this. Credit Suisse, First Boston, 1.5, Clone, 7, Rite Aid, 8, Enron, 10, Delphi, 20, Energy, 24.3, WorldCom, 25. Stock prices of these firms, no, these are the number of the years that these executives were serving, Chris. What a tragedy. What a tragedy. In athletics, one of the best trainers for character, leadership, and then we look at some of the fabrications and conspiracies that have occurred. And then we look at the student communities and who's who among American school students, periodically profiles high school achievers, around 80% of high achieving college bound students have cheated. I gave a lecture at Loyola University on the crisis character in America and business and education and sports and the presidency. And you know, I had found that in the public schools, in three public schools in Chicago, they had a win-win situation. The students would make better grades, the teachers would get promotions,
because they had a conspiracy to cheat. Win-win.
Well,
you see, the tragedy of these things is that I know a lot of these chief executives. Many of them were partly good men and talented men who destroyed themselves. My young colleague, Max Angerhall, who's traveling with me, who really runs the foundation I'm involved in, he and I know Scooter Libby, and going in to see Dick Cheney, if you read the news, he's now been charged with perjury and obstruction of justice. This administration that came to the White House, George Bush put his hand up, I pledge to bring honor back to the White House. How do we change this culture? We've got a plan. We've got a plan, and your wonderful headmaster is involved in it, because at Washington Lee University, we're going to have a convocation of school heads, university heads, business leaders, and others, and we're going to try to develop new ways to inculcate character-based leadership so that you and I, all of us, can be tempted. We did away with the day of the devil much too soon. The devil always comes up attractively dressed up. But you and I must equip ourselves with the moral compass when we get into the conflict of loyalties. Loyalties to friend, loyalties to group, and those are important loyalties. No man can do more than this, lay down his life for his friend. These things are important. So when we get into a conflict of reporting somebody in a business or in government and doing it straight up, that is brought into question. So you get in sometimes in a conflict of what appears to be right against right. And a great philosopher a few centuries ago, Immanuel Kant, wrote, but you've got to have a hierarchy of values and decide in a given situation what belongs on top. We have these presidents that have been in a hole. Woodrow Wilson did it. If you studied your history in the Versailles Agreement, he wouldn't build coalitions. There's power in building coalitions. I've written a little essay on the grace and power of civility, of inclusive leadership. But Wilson was exclusive. He took no Republicans to Paris in the negotiation of that treaty. He tried to bypass the Congress, and then he was ill, and his wife closed off the White House. LBJ, and he lost this beautiful vision of the 14 points, and that helped make the world safe for Hitler and Stalin. These are morality plays. These are great tragedies. And I know so many of the people that are in all of this. Now, part of the problem that you and I deal with, whether in the corporate boards I've served on, or the institutions I'm in, or you and what you do every day, is when you look at a given course, and you know the straight way is a tough way, it's a way maybe of short-term disadvantage, and then everybody does it the other way, and that's when your moral compass is needed. I went to what I consider the greatest military academy in the world. People in the Naval Academy, Air Force Academy would agree with that, West Point. We had an honor system, and the honor system there has operation calls. Not only do you not cheat or steal or lie, but if you see some doing it with that, I graduated in 1951, that West Point cheating scandal that broke the team. They were the national champions. Colonel Earl Blake was the coach. Blanchard Davis and all these people had built up this top team. And how did this occur? Because it's easy to cheat at West Point because the same exercise, the exam is given at different days during the week. So some of the players that need coaching, their best friends or others are coaching them, that they're bright students, and this one cadet goes to his honor cadet, where if you find an infraction that you're supposed to report it, he goes in and he says, you know, I'm here to report, whatever his name was, Bill Jones, he's a good friend of mine, he's been helping me. My grades have gone up, but I've been given the answers. And the honor cadet, the honor representative in that company looks at him and says, you did the right thing. You did the right thing. Then the devil comes into play, his morality play, except it's a true play. And he says, but you know, it's going on around here. You know, it's going on. What do we do? Greatest military school in the world, top football team in the world. We're going to blow the top up. We'll destroy the reputation of the school. So this poor kid retreats. You go through about three of those, and then a cadet comes along, and I say, along with MacArthur and Eisenhower, there should be a statue to him, except he still remains anonymous. Statue of the cadet that saved the honor code of West Point. He didn't stop there. He went on up to the commandant, Colonel Harkins, later became a four-star general and the first captain of the Corps, and told him this, and they said, the morality play goes on. You did right, you did a courageous thing coming up here, but you know, it's going on. What you got to do is stay in there, tell us more, to crack this open. What he was being asked to do is inconceivable in terms of the friends and the colleagues on the team. But what he was being asked to do was to save the honor code at West Point. When some of these people, when they're four-star generals in a place like Iraq, will have the moral compass to do the right thing in a murky situation. You know, I like to talk about the talents of great people. I see people in life that go forward and have great promise. Coach Reich, some person you've heard about around here, but when I took biology and Bible, those are two things he taught you, no longer coaching. But he talked about some people graduate with great promise, and they don't know how to take setbacks, and they don't make much of their life. Maybe it's better for a person when they're in school to have hard setbacks. Learn to deal early with a devastating setback and sort of build the moral and psychological way of dealing with it. So we all have tipping points where we can go one way or another. George Washington had a tipping point. I live in the old town of Alexandria, Virginia. At age 17, he surveyed that city. He was a hot shot. His family didn't have all that much money, unlike the Fairfaxes. And he became a major and a lieutenant colonel in the colonial forces. And he thought well of himself. And he was always arguing with Governor Dinwiddie that he wasn't getting the same pay as the regular royal forces. And so he goes over on a mission into the Alleghenies, and he camps in the wrong place and is forced to surrender to the French and Indians. He's written up the father of our country in the Times of London as a disgrace to His Majesty's service. You know what happened out of this? Some kind of epiphany where there's a change, and rather than an egotistical leader, he takes his setback, he makes his comeback. You know, he was not a brilliant general, he was a brilliant leader. He lost more battles in the Revolutionary War than he won. He just won the war. the Constitutional Convention, that man up before them, held that Constitution together because of what he represented. It came out of a setback. There was another president who had a devastating setback. Let's suppose any one of you were stricken with polio at a young age. That's what Franklin Roosevelt had. Franklin Roosevelt at Harvard was a dandy. He was from up on the Hudson, the rich kid, the ladies' man, and nobody particularly liked him. They called him F.D. Featherduster Roosevelt. He had been disloyal to his wife, Eleanor, during World War I. She stuck with him because Louis Howe persuaded him she broke and ruined his political career. And then at Campobello in 1921, he's cut down with polio, the daddy with the dead legs, his son writes. He's through. His imperious mother comes back from Paris, walks in and says, "Now you're going up to the Hudson Valley to our home, and you're going to be the lord of the manor for the rest of your life. You're getting out of politics." Eleanor said, "No, he's got a destiny. He's got to go forward." I don't know of one historian that doesn't believe that this devastating setback made him to take us from the Great Depression, where he said in his inaugural, "All we have to fear is fear itself," and then to win the Great War, all done by a man that couldn't walk. Incredible. So this is how leaders are made. I formed a center for the Strategic and International Studies, which Admiral Burke and I formed long before you were born, about 1962. And Dr. Inamori, who created Kyocera, you see those advertisements, he came from nothing. He created that, the Inamori Foundation. He is a devout Buddhist, and he believes in character-based leadership. That's his passion, and he's endowed with something called, worth $5 million, at Abshire Inamori Leadership Academy. And we have a group across the country of academies and universities, preparatory schools, public schools, that are going to join together at Washington and Lee University, where I gave a lecture on another servant leader, General George Marshall. And we're going to find how we can better inculcate, using new technologies, serious games, for example, interactive role-playing, as well as case studies in the field of sports or public service, the presidency, science, you name it. So in getting Dr. Inamori to endow this academy, I was sitting in Kyoto where they have these beautiful temples. He's a devout Buddhist. And I said, "You know, speaking of temples, you've got them in Athens and Plato there. Formed an academy that endured for 1,000 years. He felt that leadership and values can't be taught, they can be learned. And Inamori said, "Let's create an academy like that." And that's what we're trying to do in Washington with spokes. And we want Baylor to be in the lead. And your headmaster is deep into this. I've read the speech that he's given. And you know, at Haverford School up on the main line in Philadelphia, I was drawn in to give their annual lecture as they were debating an honor code and instituting it. And you know, they debated what we call the toleration clause, where you've got an obligation to report somebody or just not cheat yourself. But they took ownership. And what Bill Casey and I want you to do is to take new ownership of your code. It's your code. And if we can make this school renowned throughout the country as the lead institution, and you start getting that on your record to go to college and get a job, It will make a difference. It will make a difference. But we all need help. Character is not a constant thing. And the principles of leadership, of reaching out to people, empowering people, of having civility, managing new ideas, of getting people of talent to come together to achieve greater things. All of these are things that can be explored together in this new effort. But it's up to you, as this wonderful student body, to gain ownership of such an effort. Dr. Casey's talked about before that meeting at WNL of having some focus groups so we get close to your thinking and you get close to other thinking and get your ideas. It's been a wonderful pleasure for me to be back to Chattanooga, a great city, great history, to see the developments, to be back to this tremendous school with the leadership that you have. Thank you very much.